Hello students, welcome back to Unix programming class. Today we'll be learning about the while looping construct which is available in shell programming. You have already used this while looping. Loop means it is a repetitive structure, right? So some statements or a statement or a set of statements you will use within the loop and you will repeatedly execute it until some condition is satisfied. Right, so here also in the while loop we'll do the same. It is similar to the while loop which is available in other programming languages. So usually we use the while loop when we don't know exactly how many number of times we need to execute the loop, right? For loop is usually used when we know exactly how many number of times the loop is to be executed, right? So we have for loop also here in the shell programming. We'll discuss that after this while loop discussion. So here while loop is used for repetitive execution. So the syntax goes like this. So here is the syntax: while condition is true, so whatever the condition you give here, if it is true, then you will give do is a keyword. Okay, do and done. See, these two are the keywords which will specify the boundary of the while, what statements that has to come. See, these are the commands which will be coming within the while loop. Okay, so what statements have to come within the while loop will be, the boundary will be set by this do and done keywords. Okay, so what we use in C, the curly braces, right? So within these curly braces we'll write these statements which need to be executed in the while loop. So similar work will be done by this do and done keywords. Okay, so these keywords will tell you the boundary of the while loop. So whatever the commands we write within this do and done block, that will be executed repeatedly. Okay, so this is the syntax of the while loop. Let us see a small program of the while loop. So here I have set this answer equal to y. That variable answer is set to a value y, and then in the while loop we will test here whether answer equal to y. Okay, if answer equal to y, then the control will enter into the loop after the do. See, here the while loop starts and here the while loop ends with a done statement. Okay, so here these statements what we have here will be executed repeatedly until the condition this answer is equal to y. Okay, so now answer is already equal to y, as we have already set it. It will enter into the loop and then we will say enter the code and description. This message will be displayed. Okay, enter the code and description. That message will be displayed on device tty. What is device tty? It is a file which will specify your terminal, right? So on your terminal the code, and it will display this message: enter the code and description. Okay, after this message is read by the user, in response user will enter the code and description, which will be read by this statement: read code and description, right? Read code and description, two variables at a time we are reading. Okay, after the code and description is read, we will display the code and value of code and description. Here code and description, it is displayed. Okay, so with this OR symbol, you can see here this is the OR symbol. This is just a separator. Even in the emp.list file we have seen that separator as a OR symbol, right? So here also we will display code and an OR symbol and then the description. That is a separator between the code and the description, and it is not displaying on the terminal. Rather, this code and description will be redirected to a file called new list. Okay, it is redirected to a file called new list, and it is not simple redirection. You can see here, redirection means the greater than symbol, right? The value, whatever the command output we have, that is redirected to another file using the greater than symbol. But here you can see we have two greater than symbols. So what is the two greater than symbol? We have studied that two greater than symbol in the standard output, we have studied, right? So there, if we use two greater than symbol, or we call them as chevron symbols, if we use two chevron symbols, it is redirecting as well as appending. Okay, it is redirecting as well as appending. It will append. Append in the sense, it will not disturb, it will not overwrite the previous contents of the new list. If there are some contents in the new list file, this is the new list file, right? So if there are contents in the new list file, at the end of the new list file, the new contents will be added. Okay, so let us say some already contents are there in this new list. This is the file new list, already some contents are there. So if we say double chevron symbol, then at the end of this new list, the new contents will be added. Okay, end of the new list, this new contents will be added. So it keeps on doing within this while loop execution. Okay. So then it is added to the new list. Okay, it is added to the new list. Sorry. Okay, then we will ask the user to enter any more code and description the user want to store into the new list. And we are giving the option y or n to the user, so user can enter y or n, that means yes or no. If user enters yes, then we will take one more set of code and description. If user says no, we will come out of the program. Okay, so here we will ask any more code and description you would like to take enter from the user. So if user says yes or no, that will be stored in a variable called any, which will be read by the read statement and will be stored in a variable called any, and that any will be given here to the case as test expression. Okay, any is given as test expression. See, this any is given as test expression for the case statements. The case statement is switch statement. It is analogous to your switch statement in C. Okay, so this any will be matched with this first pattern if it is Y star or Y star. That means Y star means capital Y star. If you say yes in capitals, or if you say yes in small, both means yes only, right? Yes in capitals or yes in small. So this is or. Okay, this is or. Yes in capitals or yes in small, answer variable will be set to Y. Okay, answer variable will be set to Y. And if you say no in small or no in capital or anything, like no in capital or no in small, or you can say N in capital and O in small, any combination of N and O, if you say, see, star means N star means first character should be N followed by anything, isn't it? That is the meaning. So if you say N O in any of these patterns, then answer will be set to N. And then if anything else, this is default, right? This is default in your switch in C programming language. So here if anything else is set, star bracket means if anything else, any other option apart from this yes or no, anything else is entered, then also answer will be Y. So by chance user may enter some other character other than yes or no. Okay, so Y star means user can enter simply Y also, right? Star means any characters may be there, may not be there, isn't it? Simply Y also can be entered by the user, or simply N also can be entered by the user to specify yes or no, isn't it? So if any other character is used apart from this Y or N, then it will go to this default and answer will be set to yes. Okay, so then here the case ends. See, case, how it ends? It is the reverse of case word, right? C-A-S-E. If you read this word in reverse, it is case only. So the case block is this much. Okay, case block is this much. Case starts here and case ends here. Okay, switch, that is switch, analogous to switch in C programming. And then done. So this while loop is ending here, done. Okay, So and again it will go back. After this done, it will go back to while loop and check whether answer is y. If it is y, again the same set of statements will be repeated. One more time the code and description is accepted and will be stored in a file called new list. And again it will be asking the user's choice whether the user want to continue or not, yes or no. And then if user says yes, one more time it will be repeated. So you can create such an infinite execution of the loop by this method. Is that clear? Okay, so that is about the while loop. Okay, so this is test how you test the condition using test statement. So this is the bracket formation is another form of test, right? So this is how you can use the while loop. So let us see the execution of this program. Okay, I have typed this program as while.sh. Okay, can see this is the program. I have typed this program as while.sh, the same program. Let us execute this program. How to execute? Using sh statement, right? Sh while.sh. Then it will ask, okay, sorry, spelling is wrong. Sh while dot sh. Now it will ask enter the code and description. Okay, now we will enter the code. Code is 3, let us say. Description is book. So it will say, do you want to enter any more? I will say why. And it will ask again code and description. I will say 5, pen. Again it will ask, do you want to continue? I will say capital Y, or I will say yes. Then it will ask enter the code and description. I will say 7, lid. Okay, like this it will keep on asking you until you say no. When I say no, it is actually not this program is not taking that no as the output. Intermux or Sigwin also I tried, it is not, it is giving me the same output. When I say no, it is not terminating. So please check in Linux platform. Okay, please execute this program in the Linux platform and check. So anyway, other operations of this program are happening, but the no option when I give, it is not terminating the program. Okay, it has to terminate, right? It has to come out of the program. So it is not doing that. Okay, so please check. So now I have to say control C to come out of the program. Then you can check that code and description should be stored in new list, right? So let us check the contents of the file new list, cat new list. The thing what I have entered, 3 book, 5 pen, 7 lid, that is stored in the new list. And not only that, see, it is already storing this, you can see 2 book, then 4 pen, 5 ring, which I have inserted in the previous execution. Okay, so along with my previous execution results, it is appending my new execution results also. Okay, so you can keep on appending the values like this. Is that clear? So this is how you can execute the while loop. Is that clear? Okay, this is how the execution happens. We will ask enter the code and description, then user will say why. Then see here, user will enter the code and description. After that we will ask enter any more you want to enter, then user say why. Then again it will ask enter code and description, then user will enter code and description, which will be stored in new list, which is appended to new list actually. Then again we will ask, do you want to store any more? So here we will enter, press enter, that means no output, no specified output like y or n, then also it will be y, because in the program it is like that only, right? So anything else if you give, answer is set to y itself. Okay, so it is asking again the code and description. So user will enter code and description again, and then user will ask, do you want to, user is asked, do you want to continue, any more you want to enter. If user says yes, it will come out of the program and you can get all these code and descriptions which are stored in the new list, which I just showed you in the output of the program. Okay, this is how you can make use of while loop to perform some operations repeatedly. Okay, so next let us go for the for loop, which is also available in other programming languages. Usually the for loop is used when we know exactly how many number of times the loop is repeated. Here also the same case. So the syntax goes like this. So this is the syntax of for loop. For variable in list. Okay, so this in this statement the for word and the in word are the keywords. Okay, for this variable is an identifier, you can give any name for the variable. In and for are the keywords, and list you can give any list of variables for which the for loop need to be executed. That means you can give, let us say the list is A, B and C. Okay, let us say the list is this list. Okay, this list is A, B and C. Okay, now for first iteration of this loop, for the first iteration of this loop, A will be stored in variable. Okay, for the first iteration of the loop, A will be stored in variable, and all these executions happen. Okay, the commands what we have here, all those executions will happen for the first iteration. For the second iteration, again the control will go back to for, second iteration is started, and then for the second iteration B will be stored in variable. Okay, B will be stored in variable, and these commands will be executed, and again the control will go back to for loop. For the third iteration, C will be stored in the variable. Okay, for the third iteration, C will be stored in the variable, and then the commands will be executed. Okay, then the command will be executed, and then the control go back to for loop. Then there are no more items in the list. Okay, then there are no more items in the list for next iteration. So for loop will come out of the block. Okay, loop will come out of the for. Is that clear? That is how the for loop works. So for loop needs a list for its execution. So how many items are there in the list, those many number of times the for loop will execute. Is that clear? The for loop will execute the number of time, how many number of times that the number of items are there in the list, those many times the for loop will execute. Okay, let us see an example. Using positional parameters we are doing here, we have seen, right? So for pattern, this statement you see, for pattern dollar at do. Dollar at is a positional parameter which will store all our command line arguments, right? All our command line arguments, as a separate string, right? All our command line arguments as a separate string. For example, if I give the command line arguments, let us say sales and Jai. Okay, let us say sales and Jai. These are the two patterns which I am giving. Okay, so now first iteration, sales will be stored in pattern. For the second iteration, Jai will be stored in the pattern. Okay, only two times this for loop will execute. So after, for the first iteration, sales will be stored in the pattern, and grep will find the pattern in the emp.list. And also we have seen this execution of OR statement, right? OR, how it will execute, OR operator will execute like command 1 is false, then only command 2 will be executed, right? If command 1 is false, then only command 2 is executed. But R is little different, right? R is little different. Sorry, AND is little different. AND is totally different. If command 1 is successful, then only command 2 is executed. OR means command 1 is, if it is an OR, command 1 is not executed, then only command 2 will be executed. That is what is happening here. Okay, that is what is happening here. Let us see. Okay, so now if the pattern, whatever we have given, the pattern is sales for the first iteration, right? If the pattern is found in the emp.list file, then this statement will not be executed. If the pattern what we have given is not found in the emp.list, then it will say echo pattern not found. Pattern, the pattern name will be displayed. Pattern sales not found. Okay, pattern sales not found, that statement will be displayed. Okay, that statement will be displayed, and it will go back to the for loop for the next iteration. For the next iteration, this jai will be stored in the pattern, and then grep will search for that pattern jai in the emp.list. If it is there, then it will display the lines which are containing that jai pattern. If it is not there, then it will go to second part of the command and it will display pattern jai not found. Okay, pattern jai not found. So that is how this program is executed. Okay, that is how this program is executed. Let us see a few more examples. Here is another example. See, this for loop, it is not necessary that you create a file itself. Okay, it is not necessary that you create a file itself and then execute. You can directly execute the for loops on the command line itself. Okay, command line means in the dollar prompt. In the dollar prompt only, you can write the for loop and execute. I will show you how to do that. Okay, let us see another example here. For file in ch1 ch2, that is chapter 1 chapter 2 files. Okay, so for the first iteration, ch1 will be stored in the file, and for the second iteration, ch2 will be stored in the variable file. Okay, this is a variable, file is a variable, and this is the list of items what we have given. So for the first iteration, ch1 will be stored in the file and that will be copied. So what we are doing here in this program is we are creating the backup files. Okay, so file will be taken and it will be copied to another file called filename.back. If the file name is f1, the contents of f1 are stored into f1.back. okay, writing a dot is difficult here. Okay, so here, okay, I will write simply back. Okay, f1.back. F1 is copied to f1.back. Okay, that is what we are doing here. Copy the file to file.back. Okay, that is what we are doing here. So ch1 is taken, ch1 copied to ch1.back, and a message will be displayed, ch1 copied to ch1.back. Okay, ch1 copied to ch1.back, and then it will go back to the for loop. Okay, then again for the next iteration, ch2 will be stored in the file and then it will copy here in the statement, copy ch2 to ch2.back, and then it will display ch2 copied to ch2.back, and then it will be done. Okay, so likewise you can create the backup copies of the files in a for loop. So if you want to do many backups, say I want to take many backups for the many files, then you can use this for loop for doing that operation. Isn't it good? So let us see another example. So list from the variables. Okay, here see this statement, you can see here we have executed this statement on the command prompt itself. Okay, for variable in $path $home. Now the list is $path and $home. You can add $shell also, okay, or any other environment variable you can add. $path and $home are environment variables, right? So this variable will be storing dollar path for the first time, first iteration, and then it will say echo dollar path. Dollar path will be evaluated in double quotes, right? So the value of dollar path, that means all the set of directories which will be searched by the shell when it has to execute a command will be displayed. That is the path value will be displayed, okay, for the first iteration. Then for the second iteration of the for loop, dollar home will be stored in variable, and dollar variable, that dollar home, that means whenever a user logs into the system, a home will be allocated for the user, right? So that home directory path will be displayed for the second iteration. Similarly, if you use dollar shell, your shell's path. If you are using bash shell, bash shell path. If you are using bourne shell path will be displayed. Okay, that is how you can display all the environment variables value one after the other in each iteration of the for loop. So here you can add few more environment variables for the list. Okay, dollar pwd, dollar login, dollar shell, others you can add and execute. Okay, so here you can see in the output, first one is the path value, the path environment variable value. The second one is the home environment variable value. Okay, that is how we can display the environment variables values using the for loop. So here is the next example of the for loop. This is quite interesting. So here, if we want to perform a search operation using grep for many patterns, then what you can do, you can create a list of patterns in a file called clist. Okay, if I want to search for sales, if I want to search for director, I want to search for clerk, I want to search for marketing, I want to search for something else, some value which is starting with 2. So all those patterns, all these patterns what I want to search will be stored in a file called clist, and that clist is given as a argument, given as a list for the for, and for loop will take each pattern one by one and it will execute different iterations and will display the lines which are matched in emp.list by the grep. Okay, so we'll see how we can do that. So now clist is having all these let us say patterns, so one by one it will take, variable will take, and it will be found in emp.list. okay, we'll execute and check this. Next one is, you can also use wildcards along with the for loop. Okay, you can also use wildcards, like as a used star here. You can say star.htm, star.html. That means all HTML files. It may have HTM or HTML extension, right? So HTM, star.htm will, all star.htm files will be displayed. See here, we are displaying the contents, right? So all .htm files will be displayed for the first iteration. For the second iteration, all .html files will be displayed. Similarly, you can display all the C programs using for loop like this: for file in dot star dot C, cat dollar file. That means it will be displayed. Okay, all C files contents you can display at once. Okay, so let us check the execution of all these programs. Okay, let us check the for loop. I have stored the file name as for.sh. Let us see the contents of for.sh. So same program what I discussed just now, that I have typed and stored here. Let us execute this program. sh for.sh. Okay, I have to give the arguments. Okay, I have to give the arguments. Let us say command line arguments have to give sales, clerk, and director. I'll give, so we know that Director and sales patrons are present in emp.list, but clerk is not there in emp.list, right? So let us see what it gives. So this is the output of the program. So first three lines, first four lines, it is giving you the sales pattern. Okay, so you can see here sales is there, here also in the second line sales is there, third line also, fourth line also. So first four lines is giving the output for the sales pattern. The fifth line you can see here, the fifth line, pattern clerk not found. So that clerk is not there in emp.list, so it says pattern clerk not found. And the remaining last three lines will tell you the director, will give you the director pattern, right? So here it is giving you the director pattern. Last three lines is detecting the director pattern. Okay, likewise you can execute the for loop. So next let us check other examples. Let me clear the screen. Okay, next let us say, I can type the programs here itself. Okay, let us check the file names first. What are the different files we have? Okay, we can take F1, then XYZ node. Okay, F1, XYZ and node we'll consider for taking backups. Okay, just now we discussed that program, right? For taking backups, let us discuss. For that, let us say for file in F1 node, I can take F10 also, F10, semicolon, do CP $file $file. So this we have seen, right, how to create the variable, shell variable names, dot back. So backup files we are creating here, dot back semicolon, then echo, after copying give a message, echo $file, that is the name of the file, copied to file name dot back, $file dot back. That means F1 copied to F1 dot back, F10 copied to F10 dot back, and node copied to node dot back. Okay, so that is what we are doing here, and say done to end the for loop. So likewise you can write the whole for loop in a single command line argument. Okay, so now you can see it says F1 copy to F1 dot back, node copy to node dot back, F10 copy to F10 dot back. So multiple files if you would like to take backup, then you can do like this. You can give the output of ls command itself as the input for the for loop, then all the files backup will be taken at once, right? So next let us see another example to display all the values of environment variables. We saw the program, right? So let us check that program. For var in, see this var, file, all are identifiers, you can give any name for that. $path, the environment variable should be given in capitals. $path, $home, $shell. Okay, $home, $path, $shell. $shell, do echo dollar var done. See, it is displaying all the values. Okay, first two lines it is displaying the value of path, environment variable path. So in the second line it is displaying the path of home, and in the third line it is displaying the shell. So that is dollar shell, bash shell, it is displaying dollar shell value, right? Likewise, you can display the environment variables values using the for loop. Next, let us see how you can store the patterns in a file, and then you can take one by one as example for loop iterations. Let us create a file called CList and let us store all the patterns what we want to search in this file. Let us say sales director, clerk, then 2, 3, 4, 5, marketing and Jai. So these are the patterns which I would like to search. Okay, so all these patterns, sales director, clerk, 2, 3, 4, 5, marketing and Jai, I want to search. So let us store them in a file called CList. Okay, now the file name is CList, right? So that I will give as a list for the for loop. So how I will give, I'll say for variable in. So this var, you can give any name, that is an identifier. Then back quote, why it is used, we have studied that, right? Back quote is used for command substitution. That command is executed here and the output of which will be used for the further executions. Okay, that is using back quote. So see this, this is the back quote. Okay, then semicolon, that is not single quote, you should be careful. Semicolon, do grep dollar var, search dollar var from emp dot list, and that var will be having patterns which are stored in C list file, right? Then done. See, it is now giving you the output. First four lines it is displaying the sales, then from the fifth line it is displaying the director, next three lines, fifth, sixth and seventh line director, then it is giving you the pattern marketing. Okay, then the last one is Jai. Okay, last but one is marketing and last one is Jai, and it is not displaying the clerk. It is not, it because it is not found, it is not displaying the clerk, and also it is not giving you any message because we have not given that message here, right? Last time we have given no echo pattern not found, that's why it was displaying the message, but here we have not given that echo statement, so it is not giving any message. Okay, so then the other one is to display the use of wildcards in the for loop, to display all the contents of all C files. So let us see how many C files are there in my directory. I will say ls star dot C. So these are the C files, emp.c, leap.c, sort.c, student.c. So these are the C files which I have in my directory. So I want to display all the contents of these files. So let us write how I can write the program. For file in star.c, C semicolon, do cat dollar file. So it will display the contents of all the C files. Okay, so now see, it is displaying the contents of all the .c files. Likewise, you can write the programs for displaying the contents of any file. So like previously we saw HTML files, Java files, and you can redirect it, right? Display all the contents and redirect it to some other file. So all your C files will be available in a, all your C programs will be available in a single file. Isn't it? So likewise, you can use the for loop for repetitive action, and you will be using the for loop when you know exactly how many number of times you need to repeat the loop. It will perform each iteration for one value in the list. One iteration for one value in the list. So how many items are there in the list, those many iterations will be carried out by the for loop. Okay, that's all for today. Let us meet in the next class. Have a good day. Bye-bye.